people, it's Good Karma, and I want to thank you for joining us again this week. We are continuing in our series, Habits, and I hope that you have been blessed by the word that has come forth and the impartation that has come forth over the last few weeks. Today, we're going to dive a little bit deeper into a subject that is often misunderstood, and that's the topic of worship. Yes, worship. So before we go any further, I want you to go get your pens, your tablets, or whatever you use, your iPads to take notes, because this is going to be something that's going to help us as we move forward in our relationship with God. Understand something, we hear the term worship. Worship, I said earlier, is often misunderstood because many times people think of it as something that you do as a part of a service, a certain time of service, or a certain type of song, or many look to aspects of worship of raising hands or bowing down, which those are actually aspects of worship. But really, worship is more about the lifestyle that we live that honors God, the lifestyle that we live that speaks and says who God really is. And so you have to ask yourself the question, how can I live a lifestyle of worship? Then that means I have to take my everyday living, everything that I do throughout the day, and make that an expression that honors God. Yes, so that means that my conversation that I have with my peers and my friends, or your conversation that you have on your job, the actions that you do, the things that you do, what you listen to, what you watch, what you put in your body, all that becomes an expression of worship, and it speaks to how we view God. Worship is honoring God. It is glorifying him. And so we want to go deeper into that aspect of worship today in our lesson. And so I'm going to turn it over to our ministry partner, but I pray that your heart is open to receive the word that is going to come forth today. God bless you. See you in a few.
How many of you have a favorite sport that you watch? Now, how many of you have a favorite sports team? That could be soccer, football, basketball, hockey, or maybe even cheer. For me, it is basketball. I absolutely love that sport, and I honestly feel like I've always loved that sport since I came out of my mother's womb. Now, that might be too much information for you, but my favorite team is the Los Angeles Lakers for many reasons. One, I'm from Los Angeles, and I love the colors yellow and purple. I remember when I was young, my mom would buy all of our siblings jerseys that we get to put on, and obviously mine was Kobe Bryant, number 8, and we won back-to-back championships. And I can't tell you how elated and how thrilled I was to be able to watch not only my favorite team, but my favorite players. During that time, it was Kobe and Shaq. And they were like yin and yang. Kobe did what Shaq couldn't do, and Shaq did what Kobe didn't do, but together they worked really, really well. And I love, 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 love that team. But now, if you're just sitting here and you're thinking maybe in your seat what your favorite team is or what your favorite sport is, I want you to think just for a second about the best game your team has ever played. I got mine in my head, and I hope you got yours. They scored all the touchdowns. Maybe they did all the plays correctly. They made every shot. They drove in run after run after run. They scored double the amount of points the other team did. I mean, they just did their thing. And I can just imagine how you felt in that moment. Maybe you felt like me when Kobe and Shaq won championships back to back, excited, thrilled, elated. Maybe that's what you feel when your team does really well. after your team made that really great play, how did you react? Maybe for you, you just stood back in amazement just of how awesome everything panned out. Maybe you jumped out of your chair, you high-fived your mom and dad, or your aunt, or your uncle, your brother, or your sister. You ran around the room and made no effort to keep it down. No, it was no way you were gonna keep anything like this to yourself. Your reaction on the outside matched the emotion that you felt on the inside, and you responded to that. You weren't thinking about how to react. Your love for your team just brought it out of you. It actually brought the best out of you. Now, I want you to think about the worst game you've ever seen your team play. I mean, they couldn't score a touchdown to save their life. The shots looked so bad, it was like they were trying to miss on purpose. They allowed run after run after run. They scored less than half the amount of points the other team did, and I know what you did then. Maybe you threw your hands up and just walked away in disgust, or maybe you just held your head because you just had such a headache because of what you were watching. Maybe in the stands, or maybe from the confines of your own home while you were just hanging out on the couch. Your reaction on the outside matched the emotion on the inside in response to what your team did. Now, just hang in there with me for just a moment, because now instead of your favorite team, I want you to think about God. Now, I know this might be a little of a hard turn for you, but here's why. All throughout this series, we have been talking about how we can love and connect with an invisible God, how we can build these habits into our lives that will make knowing and relating to God happen more naturally. And isn't that what we all want? And today, we are going to talk about something that we do almost every time we are in church together. We're going to talk about something that might look strange to someone who isn't familiar with the church, but something that, if we better understand it, can help us know God in a whole new way. So today, we are going to talk about worship. A lot of us would describe worship as being that time at the beginning of church service where the band and the choir comes out to sing about or to God. And that may not seem weird to people who have been in church for a while, but to a lot of people, the idea of singing to God might seem, I don't know, you can say it with me, a little different, a little strange. Sure, we may have been to concerts or even sung at the top of our lungs in the car. I know I have, especially when I went to the Beyonce concert, because it was just everything. But those songs are usually about someone getting their heart broken, making some money, or going out with their friends. Isn't that true? So when it comes to singing songs to God or other things we see people doing during the designated worship time, it can sometimes feel strange and odd and weird. You may find yourself asking questions like, why do people raise their hands during worship? If I do decide to raise my hands, when can I put my hands down? Is there gonna be a cue of when I can do that? Some people cry when they sing at church. What if I never cry? What if I don't like or know the song? Am I still supposed to sing? Am I supposed to stand up or sit down the whole time? Or maybe, just maybe, what if I don't know God? Can I sing songs about Him and to Him still? Is worshiping just singing? What if I can't sing at all? What if I don't even like to hear myself sing? Or maybe you're asking, well, what about those, you know, strange lyrics that sometimes show up? You know the ones I'm talking about, like, worthy is the lamb that was slain, or wash me in your blood, or there is another in the fire. I mean, who is the other in the fire? That's probably what you're thinking, or maybe even some of your friends. Now, is that what worship is all about, or is there more to it? Well, just like everything that we have talked about in this series, worship is a way for us to connect to God better and to love God better. At its core, worship is simply responding rightly to God, as in making sure God is the main thing, our top priority, the ultimate being. Just think about it for a moment. We respond to things all the time. Think again about the sports team. You know, for me, it's the LA Lakers that you all care all about because I know you all are fans as well. You talk about it. You jump around when they do well, and you mope around when they do horrible. You let it play a significant role in your life. Sports aren't the only thing we do this in response to. We cry during our favorite movie. Hello, Titanic. Or we get in a really good mood when we are listening to our favorite song. We talk about the weather when it feels good outside, and we text all of our friends that new TikTok that we just discovered. We respond to things all the time. Not only that, we respond to things all the time without thinking. You just do it out of reaction. How many of you have ever gotten stung by a jellyfish? I have. You don't have to think too much about it to respond. You just say, ouch, I just got stung, somebody help, call 911. Or have any of you ever burnt your hand on a stove or a fireplace or iron? Without even thinking, most of us would typically respond by just shoving our hand in some cold water or a freezer and say, ah, it burns my hand. The point is that there are some things in life that we respond to with a natural reaction because of what it did to us. Also, we respond to things based on our experience. Here's what I mean by that. While you now jump for joy when your favorite sports team does well, you probably didn't always do that. What probably happened is that a family member or a friend responded that way, and that's how you learned how to respond. The point is, there are some things in life that we respond to because we've observed others reacting to it in such an incredible way. Whether we respond without thinking or a response comes from something we've seen, I think we all can relate to this idea of worship in some way or another. And today we want to talk about it in a way that makes it more than just something we do when our team does well. We want to talk about worship as it relates to God and who He is, a way that might help make it feel less weird or strange when we do it or observe others do it. At about the middle part of the Bible, there is a book called Psalms. And the book of Psalms is filled with, yeah, you got it, Psalms, which are basically a collection of songs and poems used for worship. You could describe Psalms as a kind of a super important playlist of music. And just like the best playlist that you and I know, there are Psalms for every kind of mood. There are songs for laughter, sadness, joy, heartbreak, wisdom, and so much more. In this book, we get to see God's people worshiping Him, kind of like we do here at church. In Psalms chapter 95, we read this. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before Him with thanksgiving and extol Him with music and song. Now, this is a very Bible-esque language. Just bear with me for a moment, but you can get the point. The writer of the psalm is saying, they are singing because the Lord was their salvation. I mean, He was their everything. They were singing with thanksgiving in their heart because God actually saved them from something, because God did something not only with them, but for them. They are responding on the outside, singing because of the emotion, the joy that they felt on the inside, because of something God had done. And He saved His people. In other words, the psalmist recognized that God was the source of this great thing that had happened, and they wanted Him to know they recognized Him and the work that He did. In the same way, this psalmist's song reminds us that nothing in the world is more deserving of our praise and worship than God. So we do things like sing songs because music has the power to take what we are feeling on the inside and demonstrate it on the outside. It puts words to our emotions and feelings, It captures a mood we maybe can't quite capture with words alone. Just think about it for a moment. Music fires us up on the field or in the weight room. Music can make us happy when we've had the worst of the worst days. Music can help us focus while we are trying to do homework or while we are cleaning up our room. Music can even be played in the background of a message like this. And for some reason, that makes us focus in more intently. You know, God created music, and God knows that music is emotional. So it helps us channel our response to who He is, but not just who He is, what He has done. The reason we collectively sing songs about God at church is to focus our emotions on Him. As a group, we declare that we are not a bunch of random people who meet just for the sake of meeting. No, we are people who worship God for who He is and what He has done. But worship is not just about emotions. It's also about humility. Whether you are worshiping privately or in a group, worship is a way of declaring, God, you are greater. I mean, so much greater than we are. You are bigger and better than we can imagine. Worship focuses our attention in one direction, and that direction is God. However, music isn't the only way we can worship God. In fact, a guy by the name of Paul writes about worship in a completely different way. He goes to say, "Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for human masters." In other words, yes, worship is singing songs and participating that way. But worship is also bigger than that. It's a way to live in light of who God is. It's not simply about music. It's not even just about emotion. Worship is about living for God. It is about responding to who He is and what He has done in all the areas of not only your life, but the lives of the other people around you. It's about getting God out of the church box we might put Him in and seeing Him as a part of our everyday life. And when we see worship this way, we see how powerful it can be. Because worshiping God helps us know Him better. Because worshiping God includes saying and repeating what we know is true about God. It reminds us of who He is and what He has done. And let's be honest, just for a second, we could all use a reminder sometimes. So whether your worship is through singing, praying, or serving, reading, walking, or anything else, remember that all of it is a chance to acknowledge who God is and what God has done. That's worship. That's a habit worth getting into. So, this week, let's work on changing the way we think about worship from just being a 15-minute time slot on a Sunday. Let's try to see it instead as a time slot in our everyday lives. Everything you do every day can be an act of worship because everything you do every day can be a response to God and who He is. Here are some ideas on how you can get started. First, get a Spotify playlist going of worship music and listen as you are working, studying, running, doing chores, etc. Another thing you can do is pick an activity you love to do each day this week, and instead of just completing it, do it as an act of worship. Meaning, find ways to do that activity in a way that would honor God. Maybe you pick sports practice and you choose to be extra encouraging to your teammates as a way to honor God. Maybe you choose to use your chores as an act of worship. You choose to thank God for the dishes you wash as an act of worship, or just not complain to your stepmom or dad as an act of worship. You are basically choosing one activity a day and turning up the God value on that activity. Or maybe try this one. Pay attention to the things that get your attention. You see something beautiful? Acknowledge God being the one behind it. Enjoying time with your friends? Remember, God created relationships and wants you to enjoy them. Every experience you have this week, use it as a chance to learn more about who God is and what God is like. Listen, no matter what you end up doing or where you end up doing it, whether it is at school, your home, or somewhere else in your community, make that your place of worship. It honors God when you do everything you do as if you are working for the Lord. Because the reality is, you are. And when you do everything in response to God, you are worshiping Him. When you worship Him, you begin to live how He lives. When you begin to live how He lives, you know Him better. Worshiping God helps us know Him better. Worship isn't only about when we sing, but singing together is a great way to worship. There is something really meaningful and powerful about a whole bunch of people saying the same words to God that we love. So let's close by singing a worship song together, reminding ourselves what God is like and why He is worthy of our attention and praise. It's not the only way to worship, but it's a great way to make God the center of your attention. And it's a great way to remind yourself that He is worth worshiping in all the areas of your life.
You know what? I'm so appreciative for the word that has come forth. And I hope that you have a deeper understanding of what worship is and how worship is more than just raising your hands. It's more than just bowing. It's more than just an aspect of service that we do. But I pray that you really see how worship can become your everyday lifestyle. And it is my prayer that you would seek opportunities to glorify God and to honor Him in such a way that those that are looking at your life and looking at my life can see God in us. So let's pray at this moment. Father God, we thank you just for your goodness and for your kindness. I thank you for the word that has come forth about worship. I pray, God, that our lives as young people and individuals that are living our lives to be dedicated to you, I pray, God, that we would take time, God, to make sure that our conversation, God, our actions, God, just our everyday living and everyday existence, God, honors you, Lord. And I pray that in doing so, God, that our friends and our peers and those that we come in contact with will say, hey, you know what? I want to know about the God that you're serving. I want to know the God that you're living for. So I pray, God, that our lifestyles would be vessels of honor, God, that you would be pleased with, and most of all, would draw others to come to know you. And so we give your name all honor and all glory. In Jesus' name, we pray, amen. Now, listen, if you have not been following along in our YouVersion Bible app, along with the Habit series, I pray that you download that today. Follow along every day this week, and let's be blessed and let's grow in the Word of God together. Much love, and we'll see you next week.